This morning I am beginning a series of sermons, and we'll be making an eventual approach to the letter to the Ephesians as we go through. But I would like to begin in a different spot, not in Ephesians, but introducing you to the people who make up that church and how they got there, become part of that congregation. I think there are many things that happen in our lives that kind of we just take on and kind of define who we are. How do you define yourself as an individual? I think that sometimes in our lives we go through experiences in our life, and that overshadows everything else that we do. You ever have a situation like that in your life? Something that's happened to you? Somebody else did something to you? You may have done a wrong choice in your life, and that choice somehow down the line and overshadows your whole life? And from that point on, you begin to make decisions and choices and reactions to people, other people in your life, and that thing kind of defines who you are. You know, sometimes that happens when you're growing up in school, and those things that bully maybe done something to you, or that nickname you got in school, or from your own family maybe. Those types of things overshadow our life. And we begin to make decisions and choices and reactions, and you know, it ends up to be reactions in many ways. And that shadow of those things overshadow us. Such as it is of a fellow named, if you would, John Newton. Those of you that know anything about John Newton, and we're going to read together the quote I have in the bulletin there, so I'm setting this up. All right? John Newton, at the age of 7, his mother died. And so his dad, who was a captain on a ship, he ended up pretty much trying to be with dad. He ended up on the ship, being out there. He was a captain, and this little boy, growing up around his dad, become really wretched in his lifestyle. I don't know whether it was to try to please dad to look at him or whatever, but he outdid even some of his, when he became a captain on a ship, outdid his crew. He was outstanding in all the worst things as you could think about. And morality was so heavy. Later on in his life, he was impressed and made to serve on a ship for the British Navy. Of course, that didn't work out well either, because he continued to try to be the big guy. Whether his life was being overshadowed there, in that case, just continue on the pattern of his life. And so he did not sit well with the Navy, the British Navy, so he gets tossed out. He soon signs on to a shipping company that took care and shipping slaves on a slave ship. These slaves coming from the West Africa. They traveled in quite a bit, and he continued with that process till he became a captain on a slave ship. Whether he had gotten some idea of God or not, we're not really sure, but on one night out there on that slave ship, the ship itself went into a severe storm and it was going to sink, but it did not eventually do that. In the midst of the storm, John cries out to the Lord, "Lord, save me. Save us. Keep us alive." And And that was a moment of faith, a crisis of faith for him. He gave up the slave business, slave trade. In fact, his whole life changed at that point, because by the end of his life, he is trying to stamp out slavery in Great Britain, along with people who, like Wilberforce, who served in the Parliament, who also had the same desire to deal with slavery, because the importance of individuals, the individuals that God made them in His image, and therefore gave importance that no man could own another man. And so he ended up his whole life from that point on. He was very much influenced by another preacher, George Whitefield. He preached and he was solely converted to Jesus. He came to Jesus in a dramatic way. It was a time of crisis. So I would like you to join with me. It's on the back of your bulletin, that quotation from John Newton. And I'd like you to read it with me, if you will. Let's do this. I am not what I ought to be. I am not what I want to be. I am not what I hope to be in another world. But still, I am not what I once used to be. And by the grace of God, I am what I am. Isn't that awesome? You think about it, what this man had gone through, and the changes in his life, and the people that built into his life, so that he became a minister in the Church of England. Became a pastor. It was soon after an epileptic fit that he had. During that time period, he wrote one of the most famous hymns that we sing. And it's been sung ever since. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch. He knew, because of the life that he led, the wretch like me. He could have allowed his debauchery, his messed up life, to overshadow everything else in his life. But he came to a moment of crisis of faith in his life, and he calls out to God, and God delivers. God changes him. And so he can say, he knows what God's grace is. By the grace, God of grace, I am who I am. It's all by God's grace. So let me share with you concerning a town. A town that is overshadowed by one darkness, a dark shadow. The town or the city is Ephesus. And Ephesus was known for one major thing. And that was one of the seven wonders of the world, and that was the Temple of Artemis. Or for others, it's the Temple of Diana. It was known, people from all Asia would come, and they would come to this temple. This was a goddess, an evil goddess, that was worshipped. And the reason I say it affected the whole town, because everything centered around that temple. What are some things? Let's think about that for a moment. One of the things was that of morality. Morality centered in the temple. You know how they worshipped Diana? Prostitution. Morality was something. It was both male and female prostitution, and that affected the morality of Ephesus. It also affected commerce and as well the economy. In fact, the temple, it was almost like a bank. People would bring their offerings and it'd go there and they could get loans and so forth from the temple. Business sprung up around the temple. Oh, you know, the little miniatures? Here's a little miniature of Diana in the temple, just like the statue, that you could be portable. You could take it with you wherever you go, around the round. If you're on a trip somewhere, you could take the little statue with you, and you could set up a little shrine in your place, wherever you are, and worship Diana. It was a portable one. But there was great business around that. So much so that when the town gets affected by Jesus moving in and the gospel coming in, there's a riot that breaks out. Diana, this goddess, overshadowed all of Asia, in fact. In fact, it was known very clearly as being something that touches everyone's life, not just in the city. So when Jesus, in the gospel through the Apostle Paul, enters into that city, things begin to change. Because Jesus has come to that town, and a transformation begins to change, begins to happen. And then, so that brings us to, if you will, chapter 19 of the book of Acts. Because we're going to deal with the shadow that's over that city, this evil goddess. There were several during the lifetime of the church, not just the Apostle Paul, but there was another fellow named Apollos. Apollos was a disciple of John the Baptist. He didn't know the complete story about Jesus coming, but he was a good teacher, wonderful teacher. And so he was in Ephesus for a while. At the end of chapter 18, we find that he's drawn aside by two people named Priscilla and Aquila. These were travelers with the Apostle Paul. They overheard Apollos teaching and saying, well, there's something not complete about what he's teaching. And so he invites him to come either to their house or aside someplace. They could just talk. And they share with him about Jesus, what Jesus' mission was, because all he knew was the baptism of John. He was a disciple of John the Baptist. So he taught the Old Testament very well. And yet, all John was pointing to is Jesus coming. And so Priscilla and Aquila, they sit down together. They sit down together with him, and he gets great help, it says, the scripture says, to those who gave grace and had believed. And so he became well known, even receiving Jesus and knowing Jesus in a personal way and having his doctrine fulfilled. Consequently, when he's in Ephesus, he's teaching. Join with me, chapter 19. It says, while Apollos goes to Corinth. Apollos was at Corinth, and Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. And there he found some disciples and asked them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they answered, no, we don't even have heard that there is a Holy Spirit. So Paul asked, well, what baptism did you receive? John's baptism, they replied. Paul said, John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, and that is in Jesus. And on hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in other languages and prophesied, and there were about 12 men in all. These 12 were in the same boat as Apollos was. They didn't know the full story that Jesus came, died, and so forth, rose again, ascended. They didn't know that part at all. All they knew was that John was pointing to the Messiah coming. I think that that's probably the first step with most of us, and that is we need more information. I mean, whatever overshadows our life, we have a certain set. Because of that overshadow on our life, we become to believe and practice things. And sometimes we even believe a lie. Or we just have a partial understanding that Jesus is not quite the way we thought he was. We think Jesus is this way or that way. When we come to Jesus, we're not just delivered from something. Right? What are we delivered from? Judgment, hell itself. Right? We're from that. But we're also delivered to something. When we have a relationship with Jesus, we are brought to a place where we can respond to him. We're brought to relationship with others who believe. We have a new insights. We begin to have a new world view. We look at things differently, and we should, because of the relationship with Jesus. This is what's happening in their lives. These 12 men. They had partial, they didn't have it all. They didn't know what Jesus did. And so they're baptized. Not a baptism of repentance, but a baptism into Jesus in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so they began. So that's not the end of their learning. Paul remains in the town. Verse 8, Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing and persuading about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them, and he took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. And there he went on for 2 years, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. It's coming to faith in Jesus. Yes, that's the beginning of the crack in the society in Ephesus. People are starting to believe. Paul enters the synagogue and he tries to persuade them concerning the kingdom of God. Jesus is the king of the kingdom. The kingdom is here, but not yet. The kingdom is present. Yes, he is. Jesus is present. But the kingdom is coming, ultimately coming again. And we know that by our own heart, that he's coming and set his kingdom here on earth. It's interesting that at this point in our text, these people who have become disciples, they're not called Christians here. Did you notice what they're called? They're called the way. The way. What do you mean, the way? Evidently, there was a transformation that's beginning to happen with these disciples. Their lifestyle began to change. So much so, they even got the title. And in fact, there were those people that didn't like that too much. In fact, it says, there are individuals who, number one, refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. The way. These people are being changed. And other people are seeing it, and they're not happy about it. Because Jesus is doing something here. Education began with Paul. He sets up, since he could not be and remain in the synagogue, he sets up in a lecture hall with his disciples, and there would be people coming and going. And you know how this gets affected by an effect onto all Asia? What's happening at the temple of Diana? People are coming and going all the time from all over Asia just to come to the temple, either to worship, for commerce, for whatever. So Paul sets himself up in a lecture hall with disciples, and anybody could come and share in it an understanding. And so he teaches. And those disciples he's teaching, where do you think they're going? They're going back home. Going back to their home. And guess what they're carrying with them? The message of Jesus. And a changed lifestyle because of Jesus. Jesus changes the same things that the temple of Diana touched. Morality, right? Jesus touches that. Economy, does God, through Jesus, touch that in our individual lives? Yes, he does. We look at differently of how we use our finances. Jesus changes things. Our lifestyle changes, and our relationships, they change because Jesus changes us, transforms us from the inside out. And so he's beginning. The crack is continuing to break open in the town of Ephesus and the relationship between the temple and the people. So God sometimes does extraordinary things just to wake people up. Look at verse 11. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that he had touched him were taken to the sick and their illnesses cured and evil spirits left them. I want you to underline that word extraordinary. These are not ordinary miracles that happen. Sometimes the Lord does extraordinary miracles, that is to wake people up, depending on how strong the evil is. In this case, they're extraordinary. I've known of people that have taken this verse and these verses about Paul. By the way, this sweatband, what profession was Paul in along with Priscilla and Aquila? He was a tent maker. So when he's talking about the handkerchief, he's talking about the sweatband. Some of you athletes wear those, the sweatband. And the apron, those are the thing, that is what a good tent maker would wear and so forth, and carry his needles and whatever else that he would carry there. Extraordinary. And there are those individuals, there's in the history of the church, particularly in the 50s, where they emphasize a point of contact. I have to have a point of contact with God. And so you would get a letter maybe in the mail that says, we've prayed over this cloth and we'll send it to you for X amount of dollars. And they use this verse. And they think, well, it's a normal thing to do. This is natural. But that's why I want to underscore this. It's extraordinary. God does things not just to keep us, and we think of him in a box. No. He does do extraordinary things. But I want you to notice the purpose. Why? Because of the shadow of the temple. God did extraordinary things to wake up people, to deliver people. And there are people in that town that faked it, that thought that if Paul was using Jesus' name and preaching Jesus all those years, they could do it too. They could copy Jesus. But the problem was that just using the name of Jesus has nothing to do with the outcome. Because the important thing is not just naming the name of Jesus, but having a relationship with him. I think this next little paragraph or two is somewhat comical in a way, but it is so sad. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say, "In the name of Jesus who Paul preached, I command you to come out." The seven sons of Sceva, Jewish chief priests, were doing this. And one day an evil spirit answered them, "Jesus I know about Paul, but who are you?" And then the man who had the evil spirit jumped on them, overpowered them. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. I don't want to minimize this. We have a hard time in our day and age to call evil evil. We do. We sometimes come up with different names for what we know is. It's even sometimes even hard for people to say, "Well, that's wrong." That's wrong. It's wrong. And those that say something is wrong or that is evil, generally what happens is that, "Oh, you're judging. You shouldn't do that. You're a Christian. You shouldn't acknowledge what is truth and right, what is evil and what isn't." And yet evil is very clear. This shows this up. And by the way, one of the reasons why this didn't work for them is because they thought it was just a formula that Paul was using. "No, we'll just throw in the name of Jesus here, and that would be all right. You know, everything's going to be cool." But the problem is that these seven didn't even have a relationship with Jesus. Relationship is more than just... It's more than just saying his name. When you're going through stuff in your life and you go, "Well, Jesus!" No. To these folks, the name of Jesus is nothing more than a swear word. And you've heard people say use it that way. Because of this incident, there's nothing hidden now. The gap is widening between the temple and the people, the temple of Diana and the people. People throughout that time, Paul is there, more Christians are added to the church, they're adding along the way, the hidden things come out. Those things that they're not just dabbling in, but comes right to the darkness of the individual's lives. And they have open confession. And when this came known to the Jews and the Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. Many of those who believed now came openly confessing their evil deeds. A number of the practices of sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. And when the calculation of the value of the scrolls totaled, it came to 50,000 drachmas. In this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. When we come to Jesus, we don't get cleaned up to come to Jesus. We say, well, some people say that. I've got to get my life together before I can come to Jesus and have a relationship with Jesus and worship God. But you notice what happened here. These people come to believe in Jesus, trusted Jesus as their Savior and Lord, and the Lord puts upon their hearts and minds, you're hiding stuff. That secret stuff. Well, everybody knows you're involved in it, but you think it's secret. And the Holy Spirit touches their lives so much so that they publicly make confession. The Lord transforms and changes us. Changes. He transforms. So as Christians became numbered along the way. You think these new Christians there in Ephesus went to the temple? Do you think that they continued on in their lifestyle that they were used to? Go to the temple, do the banking, do involved in Diana worship? No. They didn't even go and get the trinkets that aligned itself around the temple. They didn't get those little statues. In fact, they got rid of them in their homes. So what happens? What happens? Well, it affects the commerce. It affects the economy of Ephesus. And what does he do? Well, there's a guy named Demetrius, who was a silversmith. He made silver shrines of Artemis or Diana and brought in no little business for the craftsmen. He called them together along with the workmen and related trades and said, "Men, you know we receive a good income from this business. You see and hear how this fellow, Paul, has convinced and led astray large numbers of people. He is here in Ephesus and in practically the whole province of Asia. He says that man-made gods are no gods at all." And so a riot breaks out. Is that true? Man-made gods are no gods at all? Most of you probably could say, yeah, okay, yeah, I got it. Got it, right? What is an idol? An idol has been defined as anything that comes between ourselves and God that takes the prominent in our life. In this case, the overshadowing of the Temple of Diana that overshadowed that. Diana becomes the most important, not only to Congress, but for that whole city, for the individual. And it affects the economy because there were more people coming to know Jesus as their Savior. It changed and transformed, began to transform. That crack got bigger and bigger and bigger. And ultimately, the gospel gets touched in all Asia because people were coming to Jesus and their lives were being transformed and changed. And they become part of the way. The way. What's overshadowing your life? Well, how do you define yourself? What would it be? what's that thing or more than one incident in your life or some of that somebody's done to you that you can't hardly get or understand? Why did I do that? Why did I make that decision? Well, it's because of this other thing. Why did I act that way towards somebody else? I know the Lord doesn't want me to do that. Because of that thing, some of you have been through some tough stuff growing up in your homes. And that is overshadowed. But I want to share with you right now a way in which will help you deal with that. And exactly what Ephesus was going through in the beginning of the foundation of that church in Ephesus. And that is an encounter, a solid encounter with Jesus. That's where it begins. Where that thing, that incident, that person, that whatever, I don't know, you fill the blank, that began to define you as an individual, out of which you live your life, the only way you're going to do it is you've got to replace that with Jesus in your life. It's the only way. You have to Jesus has to be the replace it. You see, because only Jesus is the one that changes us, that puts that gap, puts the break between that thing that we defined ourselves as and gives us a new definition of who we are. You understand? I'm trying to be as clear as I can be. So today, as we're talking about the foundation, how this Ephesus church began, it's right here in the book of Acts. Believers began, Christians multiplied in Ephesus because of Jesus entered that town. And the gospel being preached through the Apostle Paul, also through Apollos. And at the end, the last pastor of that congregation was the Apostle John. It was after Patmos. And John settles in that town as a pastor, as a minister in Ephesus. It's not a coincidence that when you come to the book of Revelation, what do you think the first church that John writes through to, where John's heart was with the people there in Ephesus? He writes to the people of Ephesus. It is Jesus who speaks to them through John. Today, challenge to you. Whatever it is that you say defines who you are, replace that with Jesus in your life. Make that decision today. Let us pray together.